Major funding for Charlie Rose is provided by the people at DuPont, originators of products and ideas that make a difference in everyday life. DuPont, better things for better living. And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and the annual financial support of viewers like you. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
Welcome to the broadcast. Tonight, a conversation with Steve Forbes of the Forbes magazine empire about running for president of the United States.
We have a chance for the most extraordinary economic boom in this country's history. We have a chance for the first time in almost a century to help affect an international environment where trade can grow, democracy can grow, and we're throwing away those opportunities.
And two authors of recent books looking at Europe today.
A lot of people in Eastern Europe thought the West was perfect purely because their government said that the West was hell. So whatever their government said, you believe the opposite of. And they really expected that overnight things would turn into Hollywood.
And Charles Jencks on the architecture of the future.
On a computer, you can design curved buildings, for instance, as almost as cheaply and efficiently as rectilinear ones. Now, you think of New York City, which is basically a gridiron city built on a grid and vertically on a grid. That's the quintessential modern city. But now imagine if New York City were based on warps and twists and waves.
The politics of 1996, Europe after the fall of communism, and the future of architecture when we continue. In 1940, a little-known but powerful businessman named Wendell Willkie defeated his party's old guard to win the Republican nomination for president. Steve Forbes, the president and CEO of Forbes, editor-in-chief of Forbes magazine, and the son of the late Malcolm Forbes, knows Willkie's story and may decide to follow in his footsteps. Why would Steve Forbes want to run for president? Is something missing from the current crop of Republican aspirants? I'm pleased to have the man here to talk about how he sees the politics of 1996. Welcome.
Good to be here.
Willkie is a guide for you. I mean, here is, I think, a lawyer turned businessman from Wall Street who...
And who was a Democrat until a few months before the 1940 convention. But it was a unique period in American history and Western civilization, and he was ahead of the curve. His party was isolationist. He was internationalist. He was pro-growth. His party was still stuck on tariffs and anti-growth policies of the early 30s. So against all the odds, he got the nomination. He lost the election, but got more votes than any Republican before and up to 1940-52.
And what does that say to you?
What that says is that an outsider coming in, there are periods where an outsider can bring more to the political table than perhaps the experienced politicians can. I think we have that period in 1996. The political class, I don't think, realizes the extraordinary opportunities that lie ahead for this country, and they're not fully addressing the obstacles that stand in the way of realizing those opportunities.
And when you say political class, do you include the whole cross-section from the right, Gingrich and Dick Armey, and people who have fashioned the Republican majority in the House over to the presidency at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue
I would include the president, who's been a very real disappointment in the last 3 years. On the Republican side, I would include so far the Republican candidates. I'd make an exception for the two names you did mention, Gingrich and Armey. Gingrich understands ideas.
Yes.
He knows the importance of occupying the high ground, but he's not running. Dick Armey has come up with a tax plan, among other things, that I think is absolutely fabulous. And if I ended up running, I'm considering it, I would certainly run on his flat tax platform.
More about that later. He will eliminate a graduated income tax, a progressive income tax, have a flat tax.
Do away with the whole thing and start all over again. And I think the American people are in a mood for it in this post-Cold War world. starting all over again on
Forget
the tax thing.
Forget Wilkie for a second. Is it doable that someone can come from outside, and you, some reports say you'll spend up to $10 million of your own fortune to make the race? Is it doable in 1996 when you look at the head start that Senator Dole has, when you look at Buchanan on the right, when you look in between Graham and Alexander, to find a base to beat those candidates?
Well, we have over 35 primaries. The voters will make that decision. And so I think it's eminently doable because they realize that the policies of the last 40 years of the Cold War period are not appropriate for the transition from the Cold War era to the new era that we see ahead, and I think that millions of voters sense is ahead. It's like you have an Olympic runner ready for the gold medal run, but you have a 200-pound pack on that runner's back. Get that pack off, get those weights off, and we're off to the races. So I think that people sense we're not doing as well as we should, and I think that's why there's so much unease about the economy and where we're headed.
Does this mean that you find Senator Dole, Senator Graham, former Governor Alexander, and commentator Pat Buchanan less than desirable as Republican nominees?
I think they would all be better than what we have now in the White House, but I don't think they're addressing the opportunities and the needs that people sense for 96. We have a chance for the most extraordinary economic boom in this country's history. We have a chance for the first time in almost a century to help affect an international environment where trade can grow, democracy can grow, and we're throwing away those opportunities. And if we throw away those opportunities, we're going to all pay a severe price.
We're throwing away those opportunities, notwithstanding the fact that Republicans now control the House of Representatives and the Congress, and the Senate?
The Republicans are starting to make some substantive changes on domestic policy, but so far they've punted on international policy. They blew it on Mexico. They've blown it on our trade talks.
You in opposition to NAFTA?
No, I was very much pro-NAFTA.
And then how did they blow it?
But they blew it in terms of going along with that disastrous policy of last December where we encouraged Mexico to devalue the peso and set off a severe crisis that is going to lead to millions of people trying to cross the border. Mexico's going into a depression, and our exports to Mexico have plummeted. Cheapening your money, trashing your money, is not the way to get ahead. When the administration went along with that and encouraged the Mexicans to take that drug of devaluation, the Republicans should have said, this is nonsense, this is the wrong thing to do. But they just let it go by.
Give me another alternative you favor that you don't find anyone on your side of the political fence advocating today in terms of the international sphere.
Well, I think that somebody like Jack Kemp had an understanding of it. Somebody like Gene Kirkpatrick has some understanding of it. But I think you have to meld not just the traditional diplomatic military side. You also have to realize the extraordinary role that economics plays, not in terms of trade disputes, but in terms of creating an environment where other countries can get away from the clutches of our Treasury Department and the International Monetary Fund. We are giving advice to these countries that qualifies as economic malpractice. We could have prevented the hyperinflation in Russia. We could have prevented the disaster in Southern Europe. But we blew it, and we blew it in Mexico.
Okay, let's go down the list. And how have we blown it with respect to Japan in terms of the very firm stand that this administration has taken with Japan? There is some kind of, today as we talk, agreement being hammered out. It looks like that the Japanese have blinked, at least in terms of some kind of voluntary agreement from Japanese automobile manufacturers agreeing to use auto parts from other places.
Well, the Japanese auto manufacturers were quite willing to do a voluntary agreement weeks ago. In the name of free trade, and this is something, again, the Republicans didn't pick up on, in the name of free trade...
supported the president in terms of his
Yeah, absolutely. Because they looked at focus groups, which said people don't like the Japanese, so they weren't willing to stand up against the president on this. But in the name of free trade, Bill Clinton is giving more power to bureaucrats to tell companies where to buy stuff and where not to buy stuff. It's called managed trade, which is socialism light. If we want to reopen Japan's markets, we can do that through a NAFTA-like agreement, through a free trade agreement. Why hasn't anyone, there are a few congressmen who've done it, but no one has put on the table the seemingly futuristic idea, instead of these ongoing trade disputes, why not go for a free trade agreement with Japan? Why not sweep away these obstacles? Now, people say, well, the Japanese would never do it. Well, Japan is in crisis today. Their political system's in crisis. Their banking system is collapsing. They're in a recession. The mood of the voters is for reform.
All right, but
so you look ahead five
years. Okay, let's assume you're right. Wouldn't the Japanese, if they were willing to engage in that kind of NAFTA free trade agreement, have put that on the table themselves rather than facing the catastrophe they face
right now,
if, in fact, these tariffs
right now,
take place.
But right now, you have a discredited regime in Japan. The people are turning against it. At the very same time they're turning against it, we come across with a proposal that would put more power into the hands of a discredited bureaucracy in Japan. That bureaucracy, we wanted them to have power to tell their private companies how much to buy from which company. That's not free trade. In the name of free trade, Clinton simply used that as a way of winning back votes of union members in the Midwest.
You don't think Clinton believes in his own policy then? Do you think it's simply a political ploy and
it was opportunistic.
Not good economic sense
If he wanted to really open up the Japanese market, there are other areas, Kodak and Federal Express and other areas in agriculture and financial services where substantial progress can be made. He simply picked that and did it in a confrontational way for politics.
But, Mr. Forbes, you seem to suggest that the Japanese are completely willing to 100% engage in free trade because they would be willing to accept a NAFTA kind of agreement if it was put on the table. And there's no evidence in the history of these negotiations that they want a complete free trade. They want to, through a series of...
If you want something to happen, you have to take the lead and bring people along. When Ronald Reagan proposed a North American free trade agreement 15 years ago, people said, that can never happen. That's outlandish. It took 6 years to get an agreement with Canada, took over 10 years to get an agreement with Mexico, but far-sighted leadership means you go beyond the current focus group and say what is best for the future, and you start laying the groundwork for it now.
And
it won't happen now, but 5 years from now it might happen if we start now.
What about Bosnia? What would you do?
Well, first of all, you take off the arms embargo. The Bosnians are quite willing to defend themselves, just as the Afghans defended themselves against the Russians when they finally got some good weaponry. The Bosnians can do the same. And when they do, then the aggressing Serbs will realize they can't do it by aggression, and you might be able to get an agreement.
And if it puts the UN troops there at risk,
the
peacekeeping
UN is
troops,
doing
you would
more,
simply withdraw them?
They're doing more harm than good. They're in effect providing a shield and providing hostages for the Serbs to continue their genocide, continuing to shell these cities
with
civilians.
And would you use American troops to help rescue and evacuate those UN troops?
You would not put, there's no need to put American ground troops in.
To help evacuate, not in terms of using as an offensive force.
You put them in, and it's very hard in that region, in any region, to get them out.
Yeah. Let me talk about domestic economics. You favor what kind, you have been involved with Christine Whitman, the governor of New Jersey, in terms of her proposal and her tax cut proposal, which helped elect her governor in her most recent election. You also have given some advice, I understand, to Governor Pataki, who will be making his own tax cut proposals here in this state. What is it you would do with respect to tax policy on the national level?
Well, you first of all realize you have to begin, what is the greatest obstacle to creating better jobs, to doing all the things we want to do? It's our monstrous tax code. You couldn't, as a human being, couldn't consciously devise something more horrific, more deadweight on the economy than that thing. So scrap it. Start over again. Start with a clean slate. Put in something like Dick Armey's flat tax plan. Do away with all the 400 deductions so you don't spend 6 billion hours a year filling out the tax forms, $300 billion complying with the tax code. So if under a flat tax, a family of four would pay no federal income tax on their first $36,800 of income. Anything above that $36,000 level would have a flat rate of 17%. There'd be no personal tax on investment. That would get this economy going. You'd have a low tax rate, which would provide a lot of incentives. You'd have a greater pool of capital. You could actually fill out your tax form on a postcard.
And
productivity, imagine all that brain power, all the brain power that goes on this deadweight, unproductive tax code would be released to do something productive for the economy. And it would remove corruption.
Yeah.
Look at all the political contributions that are made to influence the tax code. It's undemocratic. It's immoral. Scrap it.
What do you think of the idea of eliminating the income tax and not having a flat tax rate, but some kind of national sales tax as proposed? I think Chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee, Archie, believes in something like that.
Right. He does.
In various variations
when
of that
one of
out
the,
there.
One of the candidates, Senator Lugar of Indiana,
right,
has
exactly
come out
right.
in favor of it. I think that politically it's a much harder sell to do an 18% national sales tax. There's very real problems, technical problems on putting a tax on services, and if you just do it the way the states do it, it wouldn't be at 18, it would be more like 30 or 35%. You have the problem of fairness under the flat tax. You'd have millions off the tax rolls entirely. Under the sales tax, how do you get money to those who are in low incomes? Otherwise, it's very regressive. So I think it's, I think the
flat tax is a better way to go,
way
in
to
your
go.
Judgment.
Yeah.
When you, what about the president's middle class tax cut? What do you think of that?
It's simply trimming the edges. It doesn't get, doesn't provide incentives. It's simply a gimmick. It sounds good. It doesn't really work. It doesn't do the job. Scrap and start over. Let's really do it right.
If Jack Kemp or Newt Gingrich were in the race for the Republican nomination, would you still be considering an independent run?
If Jack Kemp were in the race, I'd have been backing him. I tried to get him into it, along with many others, when he withdrew in January.
Because there is
very disappointed.
And is it fair to say, because of your close political relationship with him, because you both consider yourself economic growth proponents and believing in lowering taxes that will increase economic growth, that in a sense, if they want to know what Steve Forbes believes in terms of economic policy, look closely also at what Jack Kemp believes and has advocated over the years that he's been in the Congress?
I've been known Jack Kemp for 20 years, and we've been on the tax-cutting barricades for 2 decades. So, yes, we are in sympathy on that. But one thing that gets overlooked in this whole thing is they try to make a distinction, a lot of people, between economics and values. They're both sides of two sides of the same coin. Values, I'm not talking about theological right. value. I'm talking about hard work, thrift, trust, looking ahead, willing to take risks. That is the essence of values. And the whole thing on taxes, if you want a better moral tone in this country, start with the most corrupt thing we have, which is the tax code.
There is a couple of things before we go. Mm-hmm. One is that Congressman Kemp also, and former HUD Secretary Kemp, also was known within the Republican Party as very sensitive to the poor, more than any other Republican that was considered a presidential possibility. Would you also take that mantle in terms of someone who is saying to his party, we have got to be more inclusive of those that we bring to our standard?
Absolutely. If you have a country where a certain amount, number of people are moving ahead, but others don't have the chance to move ahead, you've failed. You got to make a chance for everyone to move ahead. And I'm one of those who is not pessimistic about the inner cities. I think that if you have some of these reforms, you're going to see an extraordinary transformation. People don't want to live like that. And with a few changes, I think you're going to see hundreds of thousands of those people say, we can make our lives better, improving the education system and other reforms. And it'll happen. We've had reform movements before, and I think we're going to have a series of reform movements again. It's going to be good for all of us.
It's great to have you on the broadcast. A lot of things that I look forward to talking with you, because there are a lot of people have recognized you've been outspoken and listened to the message you bring and talk about some of the cultural issues that are going to be part of this campaign. I hope we can do that at another time.
Terrific. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Steve Forbes. We'll be right back. Stay with us. After the Berlin Wall fell, the European countries who were once behind the Iron Curtain faced two central problems. One, how would they deal with those individuals who collaborated with the old regime? And two, who were they as a country? We'll look at how Germany, the Czech Republic, and Poland have developed since 1991 with two authors. Tina Rosenberg, she is the author of The Haunted Land, Facing Europe's Ghost After Communism. She was the first freelance journalist to receive a MacArthur Genius Grant. Also with us, Marc Fischer. He is the author of After the Wall, Germany, the Germans, and the Burdens of History. He's a former bureau chief for the Washington Post in Bonn and in Berlin, and I'm pleased to have both of them here at the same time. Welcome.
Thanks.
Let me first talk about, we'll come to Germany and have you join in, but you've traveled throughout that area as well. The Haunted Last, Facing the Ghost After Communism. Give me the overview of what's going on these countries after the wall fell, after the enormous changes, and all of a sudden those who had governed and had power over your life were no longer in that oppressive role.
The countries I've written about in my book are all doing different things to deal with the past, right. But they're all really trying to wrestle with the same problem, which is, how do you define guilt? That's one of the biggest ones. I mean, these were societies where it was normal to collaborate with the government. I mean, the third grade teacher who taught history as the glorious march of the proletariat, that was in a sense being a collaborationist. These were societies that could only have functioned because they had the complicity of almost everyone in the country. And now people are struggling with how you deal with that. Who was guilty? What were the crimes? And who has the right to judge?
And what is a crime?
And what is a crime? I mean, these were not countries that were characterized, at least in the last 20 years or so, by huge amounts of violence. So you're talking about crimes that are really hard to define.
Like what?
Well, for example, the secret police. People were spied on. That's one thing that people are extremely mad at the communist regimes for. People felt that the secret police, especially in Germany and the Czech Republic, Czechoslovakia, really was an intrusive presence in their lives, tracked them everywhere. I mean, they had cameras in Catholic confessionals, in the men's rooms. I mean, but what was criminal about that? Of course, spying on people was the law of the land at the time. People were bribed into spying on their neighbors and their co-workers, but there was no existing law that they broke. And now the problem is, can you go back and prosecute those people for being good citizens?
And also the incredible moral dilemma of things that people did because of the oppression in order to protect a loved one. The terrible dilemma faced by so many people,
right,
in which they did something out of the best of intentions, even though they knew it was the wrong thing to do. And now,
a lot of people whose names are listed in the secret police files are people who outwardly collaborated but did not hurt anyone. I talked to one man who was asked to spy on his company that he worked for, and he went into his boss and he said, look, you know, the secret police is after me. And the boss said, well, don't worry, we'll sit down and talk about it every month and I'll give you a story and then you can take it in there. And he did, and this was with the full cooperation of the place he worked, but now he's listed as a secret police agent in the files. Now, is he guilty? They have a new, one of the ways that Czechoslovakia dealt with the problem of what you do with these secret police collaborators is they passed a law called Lustrace, which has been very controversial. It took everyone whose names were listed in the files as having been a collaborator and banned them from holding top government jobs for 5 years. And it was hugely controversial because a lot of people are in the book who actually did no harm, and a lot of the names in the book are wrong. And now they are being banned without a trial, and really, in a way, it smells of communist thinking.
And what's amazing to me to know this story and what I've read about your book, it is that in France, they are still to this day haunted by the question of who did what with the Nazis. And people's stories are still coming out. Witness the story of what Mitterrand may have done with the Vichy regime. What happened in Germany, and what's the dilemma there, and the burden of history for those Germans? Especially East Germany.
Well, it's really a double burden that the Eastern Germans face, because they are now emerging from three generations of dictatorship, from the Nazi and communist periods, and they find themselves, after the fall of the wall, finally being able to confront the Nazi period, as well as dealing with the neighbors who betrayed on them, the spouses who betrayed them. It's a tremendous burden they face, and in addition, they have their confrontation with their West German cousins, who came in with all sorts of goodwill after the wall came down, and then many West Germans decided to work through their own guilt and their own shame over the Nazi period by imposing an approach to justice on the East Germans. The West Germans never finished their denazification process, and after the wall fell, they went into East Germany and they said, we're going to prosecute some of the border guards, we're going to prosecute some of the members of the Politburo. And a lot of East Germans, their resentment against the West Germans is something fierce. And the resentment was built up by this spectacle of the West Germans coming in there and giving them, imposing their sense of morality. And
yeah. I guess the two examples that are spectacular are, one is the border guard. This is the border guard who shot the last person to die trying to cross the wall.
Now, there were three young border guards. Two of them, I believe, were under 20 when the incident occurred, and they were put on trial. And it really was something of a show trial. It took place in a West Berlin courtroom with West German prosecutors and West German judges, And the Easterners sat back in the spectators' rows watching this and really feeling as if they were under the thumb of a foreign country.
The German government made a huge miscalculation in choosing to put on trial the littlest fish first. I mean, you had their superiors who gave them their orders. They would come in every day and testify for the prosecution at the trial, and then they would leave, free men. And if they worked for the government, they even got a day's pay for doing this, for taking their time, their precious time, to come to the trial. So here, for a while in Germany, the only East German officials who were actually prosecuted for the crimes of the regime were four 20-year-old border guards. It was ridiculous.
And it was interesting to see how the average East German's attitude changed as that prosecution proceeded. At the very beginning, one of the families I profile in the book said, they were just adamant, we got to get the guys who were in charge of this country, the people who repressed us for all these years. They wanted the Politburo members brought to trial, they wanted Erich Honecker brought to trial. Then they saw these young border guards coming in, and initially they said, well, let's just get any of them. But as they watched this trial proceed, they became incredibly sympathetic to these poor young kids who were, in the classic phrase, following orders.
And they were chosen for this job of being a border guard specifically because they were most apt to follow orders. They were from small towns or places that could not get West German television. They did not choose people who were apt to ask questions.
And a lot of folks all around East Germany really saw a little piece of themselves in these border guards, people who were just trying to get by. It was just their job, and everyone made compromises in that society.
What happened to Marcus Wolf?
Marcus Wolf
is this famous spy chief in East Germany.
He was, and he fell victim to this West German desire to bring to impose some sense of justice, and he was brought to trial and convicted. And
of treason.
Of treason.
It's a very strange
when
charge.
He was doing exactly what his West German counterparts were doing. He was in charge of
the
foreign intelligence.
He was doing what George Bush was doing.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. He's in charge of the foreign intelligence operation of a legitimate country. And of course, his main crime was to be on the losing side in history.
Then,
but he's a free man now.
Yeah, how did he get free?
There was a constitutional court, the highest court in Germany, basically threw out a whole bunch of these cases, saying that you really can't prosecute people for violating the laws of their own country.
But where do you end up in the end? And maybe Jaruzelski is a good example. With people who are head of a state apparatus.
You cannot prosecute someone for being head of a state. What you can prosecute Jaruzelski for, I think, is, for example, in 1970, when he was defense minister, there were protests in the Polish city of Gdansk, and police opened fire and killed a lot of people. And Jaruzelski, as defense minister, gave the order to those soldiers to fire. That is something you can prosecute
then
him for.
Then after Deng Xiaoping dies, are you suggesting that people perhaps can prosecute people who gave the order to fire on people at Tiananmen Square?
If the Chinese are lucky enough to have changed their regime enough so they could have a trial like that, I think it's absolutely appropriate. People who commit physical violence, who torture, who murder, must be prosecuted. Then those were crimes when they were committed.
How do we know, okay, the crimes that they committed, then how do you know that Marcus Wolf and people operating for the Stasi, the East German intelligence, didn't commit crimes that they shouldn't have done in terms of coercive acts?
If Marcus Wolf was helping West German terrorist groups, or if he sponsored any sort of assassinations, he should be prosecuted. What he shouldn't be prosecuted for is spying on West Germany.
Yeah, and they've taken it to a ridiculous extreme in some cases. Erich Mielke, a member of the East German Politburo, old senile man at this point, was tried not for any of the crimes that he committed supposedly on behalf of the East German communist government, but because of a murder he was involved in as a young policeman in 1932, and that was the one way the West Germans could get after
him. Two tyrannies ago.
You know,
he was the head of the most hated organization in Germany, the Stasi, or the secret police, and of all the things they could try him for, they chose something that had absolutely nothing to do with the crimes of the East German regime.
If Honecker hadn't died, would he have been?
I think he would have been legitimately convicted of having issued the orders to the border guards to shoot at the Berlin Wall. I think that would have been fine, because Honecker knew what he was doing. He was the head of the state. He issued orders to kill people for no other reason than they were trying to cross the border of their country. That's different than trying someone who's 21 years old and who is acting under orders, and who it never occurred to him that there might be something illegitimate about
this. And yet, by the time Honecker was brought to trial, the cynicism in East Germany about this whole process had risen to the level that no one, it was hard to find people who were really emotionally involved in that trial.
How serious is the breach between today in Germany, between East and West, East Germany and West Germany?
It's very serious, and I think the government botched this because there was an opportunity to bring those two peoples together. After the wall fell, people started to realize that they'd grown much further apart than anyone had anticipated. Families that had exchanged Christmas gifts over the years finally met face to face, and they realized their expectations and their values had really changed.
They've been
over
living
40,
on two very, very different systems.
Absolutely.
Do they now, those people in East Germany, you think, prefer the old system to the present system?
There's a kind of false nostalgia that's developed for the old system. They crave the stability, the cradle-to-grave security that the system offered. They miss the child care. That system has been taken apart. They miss the health care.
But hasn't West Germany poured billions of dollars into East Germany?
Absolutely. And on the economic side, the East Germany is coming along. It's been an extraordinary commitment, inconceivable by American standards, of tax money, public spending that has rebuilt the infrastructure in Eastern Germany to the point where it's going to be the state-of-the-art system, railroad, telephone system in all of Europe. But they neglected the social and psychological side, and it's remarkable as you meet East German families to see how deep the resentment goes, the feeling of being a second-class citizen. There's one family I profile in the book where they went to the West and they felt themselves being insulted every step of the way, people making jokes about the way they talk, the way they dress. They ended up going back home to Eastern Germany.
People had unrealistic expectations, though. I think people, a lot of people in Eastern Europe thought the West was perfect purely because their government said that the West was hell. So whatever their government said, you believe the opposite of. And they really expected that overnight things would turn into Hollywood. And there was no way that anything could happen that would make people completely satisfied with the transition.
Vaclav Havel. What happened to him?
This is a story that I think shows why the secret police files are unbelievably unreliable. Havel, in 1965, was a dissident and a young playwright, and he was visited by an agent of the secret police who decided he would try and recruit him. And Havel was very polite to him and did not help him in any way, but as he was leaving said, "Thank you very much for coming. You have given me some good material for my next play." Well, the agent, who was not very bright, I guess, went back to work and wrote a report saying, you know, he shows a very positive attitude towards our organization, and they put him down as a candidate for recruitment, and nothing ever happened with that. And as it turned out, in Havel's next play, he did have a home visit by the secret police, but since he hadn't read his file, he didn't quite capture how crashingly stupid the whole thing was. But that shows you the kind of names that end up in the secret police file. I mean, this man was not a collaborator. He was, you know, making an ironic comment, that's all. And the books are really full of names like this. It's interesting. Germany and Czechoslovakia have taken two completely different approaches to deal with the secret police files. In Germany, the files are open. If you were spied on, you can request your file, and you can find out who spied on you. And this has been a tremendously traumatic process in Germany. There are people who found out that their husbands, their fathers, their brothers, their closest friends had betrayed them. And it is causing this national convulsion as people sit down and try and cry together and work these things out together. But I think this is a very healthy process. And people need to understand how the Stasi worked. And people need to understand how it recruited the collaboration of good citizens.
Some good does come of it, but there's a danger to it as well. I've seen too many people become obsessed with their files, and they sit there poring over them page by page, trying to relive the past, trying to remember what meeting occurred where and who betrayed them when, and it prolongs that period in a way as well.
But it's much better than what the Czechs have done. The Czechs, the Czechs have the files in the possession of the Interior Ministry, which means that they're held by one political party, and the only access a citizen has is you will get a piece of paper that says either yes, you were a collaborator, or no, you were not. You don't know what you're accused of, who accused you, what's in the file about you, and on the basis of that piece of paper, huge decisions are made about your life. And I think that is a system that is really open to political abuse.
One last point. How many former communist people who were part of the government are now, in a democratic system, being elected to power.
Well, in Germany, the former Communist Party in the East is actually doing quite well, in part because of this false sense of nostalgia where people are remembering things better than they really ever were. But the Reform Communist Party is also playing something of a constructive role because they are the only party that's representing the interests of these 16 million East Germans in a larger country of 80 million. The other parties have basically ignored the Easterners as a people, even as they invest heavily in the infrastructure of that society.
And that Poland and Czechoslovakia.
I think the Czech Republic is one of the few countries in Eastern Europe where former communists have not been brought back to power. It is a phenomenon in almost every country in the Baltics and in Eastern Europe that the former communists are doing extremely well. And I think this is part of this false or true nostalgia that people have for the security that they had when the communists were in power.
And also something about, I guess, the skills of power and the manipulation of power that they understood.
Right. The people who were operators and could do well in the old system are operators and
exactly.
can do well in the new system.
Thought.
And if there was a third system, they would do well in
exactly.
that.
Exactly. The haunted land facing Europe's ghost after communism, Tina Rosenberg. After the Wall, Germany, the Germans, and the Burden of History by Mark Fisher. A look. Two perspectives on what is happening in Eastern Europe and merits attention to understand the dynamic of how countries deal with their histories. Thank you both. Pleasure.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Ever since he gave the movement its name in the 1977 book, The Language of Postmodern Architecture, Charles Jencks has defined and defended postmodernism. He has now written The Architecture of the Jumping Universe, which will be published in June. I'm pleased to have him on this broadcast now. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming here. Tell me about this, only because you are talking about ideas that not traditionally thought of in terms of architecture. Tell me what you have come to here and what ought to be said.
Well, my theory in this is that not only architecture is changing, but culture is changing generally because of these new theories of science, coming from science.
Now, is architecture lagging further behind those changes than other?
No, I see the shift really as a cultural shift, and architecture is right there at the forefront of the change. But the ideas are really coming from cosmology, from the sciences of complexity and our new view of the universe. And this will change everything, including religion. In other words, I'm talking about the biggest shift in the West since the 12th century, not a small little jump. I'm talking about the big picture.
Yeah.
And I'm saying that, you know, the Christian story of Genesis and the modern story of the universe as a machine, both of those stories, in a sense, have been supplanted by this new story of cosmogenesis. It's a story of where we're at today and where we're going. So it's the most powerful narrative we've had.
And what is cosmogenesis?
Comes from the two parts. One is the cosmic universe, the universe as a whole, and the other part is genesis, a generative quality. In other words, it's a self-organizing universe, which is always attaining new levels of complexity, new levels of organization. And it's getting there through a series either of slow, gradual stages or jumps. And my book is really about the jumping quality, much more humorous, playful, creative quality.
Are there architects now that are reflective of what you're talking about, that are doing things that are reflective of what you...
Very much so. There's Peter Eisenman, who I put on the cover. He's the most...
Right, let me show this.
He's the clearest example of an architect who uses science for its creative potential. And then there are a lot of other architects, such as Frank Gehry, who is intuitively involved in this.
Both of them have been on this program.
Oh, have
they?
Yeah, yeah. And then there's Indian architects, Charles Correa, and Japanese architects. There's Itsuko Hasegawa, a woman architect. So this movement, it's variegated, but it's quite international. And
what do they share as architects?
Well, they share partly a common language or aesthetic, a style, if you like, a style of waves and twists and folding. There's a common new language of design which is emerging. And they may share a similar kind of philosophy. And that philosophy is related to the science of emergence, the science of complexity, and so forth. There's difference in here. I'm not arguing that there's a single movement or a single philosophy that they all share. But like a lot of periods in history, you know, the people come on board a little bit later or sooner and more or less consciously. I believe in 10 years, though, it's going to be, by the millennium anyway, that it will be a dominant in architecture. Yeah. It's coming out of computers, for one thing.
And how so? So that, well, you tell me.
Well, you see, it's hard to design a building based on all the different complex requirements. And if you can model it on a computer, you can design curved buildings, for instance, right, as almost as cheaply and efficiently as rectilinear ones. Now, you think of New York City, which is basically a gridiron city built on a grid and, right, and vertically, right, on a grid. That's the quintessential modern city. But now imagine if New York City were based on warps and twists and waves and things that are much more close to what we know as nature. It would be much more voluptuous, much more humorous.
I want to just be illustrative of this,
okay,
and you help
me. Well, there's one. I mean, there's the Gary building in...
This is the Guggenheim Museum.
The Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao, Spain.
Yeah, take a look at this if you can come in. Just tell me exactly what this illustrates for you.
Well, like the Guggenheim in New York, of course, yeah, it has a few curves, but they're like the growth
Frank Lloyd Wright once again was ahead of his time, or...?
Frank Lloyd Wright definitely relates to this movement,
yeah,
but this movement I'm talking about is much more science-directed.
Right, I see.
Now, that's rather like, there are rectilinear parts in here, and like a riotous flower or even a weed, it's burgeoning out, just the way life shows you how incredibly strong it is to get through itself. That directly shows you the relation between non-linear forms worked out on a computer so that there's no wastage of material or very little waste, and so that you can figure out all the structure in here.
And what shortcuts do you take because of this, because it's coming out of the computer?
Well, you can resolve things, down to the millimeter. And this building here, which is the Waterloo Station,
yeah,
that's built, it's a train station with the high-speed trains coming in. Now, look at all the glass in here.
Yeah.
That rippling effect is the kind of thing that could have only been designed and built because of a computer. In other words, there's 17,000 glass panels all cut a little bit differently. So as a train rumbles in there and has to stop, the whole building sort of moves.
Yeah.
All right? It's a moving architecture.
What got you interested in this? I mean, how did you come to this?
Well, the last 10 years, I've been very interested in the way science is itself shifting in a much more positive direction. I mean, what science is telling us about the universe is really exciting.
Now, let's take a look at this. Yeah, go ahead.
There's a Frank Gehry,
right,
in Switzerland, and that shows Frank's translating what it could be called worms or vermiforms into and boxes into each other so that it has the economy of a box, but the twists and warps of a living organism. So it's typical of the new hybrid between halfway between a, if you like, a rectilinear building and a more supple, smooth building.
Bob Stern was here recently, and I said to him, are we still in postmodernism? He said, yes.
Mm.
And I said, is there a new period emerging?
Mm.
You would seem to say yes, that we are about to enter in the next 10 years. And what will its name be?
Well, you see, I agree with Bob that the postmodern is a larger label. In other
right.
words, this is one of the, this will be a dominant postmodern movement, a cosmogenic architecture, I
right.
call it cosmogenic. There's a lot of other words for it.
Yeah.
But that's the word that I think is most important. Now, it's part of the postmodern movement. So it's the second stage of postmodernism, if you like.
Yeah.
The first stage was in the late 70s and early 80s, was much more eclectic, much more pluralistic. This one is really going back to universals. You know, this is telling us about what the universe really is.
Yeah.
In that sense, it's rather like the Egyptians building pyramids or the Christians building Chartres Cathedral. This is fundamentally involved in what science is telling us about who we are in the universe.
Yeah.
That's why I think it's so powerful. I mean, really, I feel, you know, we live in a media age where I live in London, the United Kingdom of Prince Charles, and I come to the United States
yes.
of O.J.
Yes.
And, you know, when everything in the
what
public
kind of culture
realm...
What shock is that?
Well, I mean, it's the hyper-trivialization
yes.
of the... which has to represent the public realm, is looking for something that's more important, long-lasting than
yeah.
media events.
Sure.
It's driven to a connection, and I believe culture will be generally. In other words, I think this is this represents more than architecture,
uh-huh.
I feel. I think we're really living through, as I say, an extraordinary shift. After all, I mean, science is telling us really what the universe is. Of course, it has to be interpreted. I'm not saying that scientists themselves may be saying this, but the evidence they're showing us of an incredibly generative, much more creative universe than we ever thought before.
Now, did you have a scientific background at all, and or scientific education?
I studied lots of things, literature at Harvard and design, right. but I was not trained as a scientist. Yeah. No, but I've consulted with them over the last 10 years, so I've worked closely with scientists. And I would say the science in the book, I would say, is 50% standard. Yeah. I'm not trying to pull any faster. The other 50% is somewhat controversial. I mean, there's Lovelock's Gaia theory.
I just want to show a couple of things before we go here, before we talk about other things. Tell me about this building.
Well, that's another Gary building for the Vitra Furniture Company. It's their Museum of Furniture display, and it shows these wonderful, again, box-like worm forms pushing together. And it is quite abstract, so its representation of these twisting, moving forms is, you could say, an abstraction, but it's quite beautiful, almost like a cathedral. I mean, it's a little church of furniture.
Tell me how the politics will mirror what you are talking about. I mean, as you see the architecture as part of the culture changing, how do you see the politics of the world changing?
Well, as we can see...
And religion as well, and coming to that first.
Yeah, I see the politics trying to come to terms with chaos and catastrophe. In other words, we know, today's explosion, for instance. Is a classic negative example of the jumping quality of the universe. In other words, we live in a violent universe, and we've suffered six major catastrophes. I'm talking about Earth catastrophes, where, 95% of the species have been wiped out, right? Mm-hmm. That's a jump, a negative jump, and there are those jumps, and I think we have to, we know that. We didn't know that 10 years ago, right? So this kind of information coming from cosmology and science is telling us that the generativity of the universe, one of its negative side effects is that, species like dinosaurs get wiped off. Yeah. And therefore, and sort of negatively, politicians are hiding behind some of the implications of the chaotic unpredictability of things. And they won't make decisions. So I see, uncertainty in politics as part, is, uncertainty in the universe. That's real. That's the negative side. But the positive side is the increasing organization. And I mean by that not just order, I mean the increase in complexity, sensitivity, think of that, feeling, intellect, and all the qualities that lead to a better life. In other words, we're talking about an increase in quality because at the end of the day, that's what complexity is talking about. And you can actually measure it, funnily enough. I'm not saying that you can measure the increase in the quality of life.
But we can measure what?
You can measure the quality of, say, the computer program that replicates life. In other words, if we want to say, is this animal more highly developed than another? Is the quality of this work of art higher on a certain level? You can measure that by measuring the computer time and energy taken to reproduce it. And so you get an index, which I discuss in my book, of objective evaluative measurement. Now that's only one measure. I'm not trying to say that's the only one, but I'm saying that that's cosmic. That's really important. I mean, it's really its implications are sacred. In other words, you're talking about something that transcends you and me and everybody out there. It is something out in the universe. The universe, you see, what science is telling us basically in its most radical moments, and this is why it's religious, is that the universe probably knew we were coming. We are built in fundamentally into the laws of the universe. It had to produce something like us, if not us, like not you and me talking, but something like us. Now that...
Wait, slow down for me just a second there. It knew we were coming because it had what kind of laws built in? What kind of immutable laws of science that were there, that were part of the structure of the universe?
The universe doesn't have one law, but the overall tendency, which amounts to a law itself, is increasing complexity. The universe has to evolve to higher levels of organization and complexity, both for unliving things and living things. That general trend, which is against the law of entropy, the second law of thermodynamics, is built into the universe. And in the end of the day, it must produce sensitive, people-like species who worry about the problems that you and I are worried about and enjoy art and enjoy food and enjoy the things that culture is all about. It must produce culture. Yeah. The universe ends in culture. And That's why architects, I mean, the word culture comes from cultivation, comes from wine, you know, cultivate wine. And one of the things I'd say in the book is that you lay down a wine, you cultivate it, you lay it down longer, it becomes a better wine.
Therefore,
you know, in terms of your own evolution, where have you come in terms of, in a sense of one of the founding fathers of the literature of postmodernism,
right.
One of the definers of postmodernism. How have you changed in terms of your own in your own adulthood in looking at architecture and its place?
Well, I see the wide picture says that, you know, there's many dimensions of current architecture. There's modernism continues, all right? 50% of the buildings you see going up in New York City will be late modern, in other words, hyper-modern. Another 20% may be a little bit postmodern. And then a lot of them will be vernacular, classical. And this pluralism is, you know, something that we're all very aware of, and in fact, I think most of us support. So my background has brought that kind of pluralism, and I write about other than postmodern things. You know, my background is not from architecture, actually, it's from literature.
Right.
Yeah.
And what led you, what was the attraction to architecture coming out of design?
Well, I studied it at Harvard. I got involved with the work of Le Corbusier, Ronchamp, to be specific. Yeah. And I'm interested
but
in that.
But then we're talking about fathers of modernism.
Absolutely, the father of modernism.
And then you turned against.
I considered a turncoat.
Yeah.
But, you know, I knew old Gropius, the other father of modernism. And in a way, in a way, I think they were really getting tired. And Corbusier said at the end of his life, you know, the youth are right, the old guard has got it wrong. And it's clear that, in a certain sense, postmodernism is being more true to the spirit of modernity. And again, in this book, I discuss how the early Bauhaus was very involved in cosmic questions, led by a spiritually directed movement. Kandinsky had written The Spiritual in Art,
right.
Came to the Bauhaus to teach,
and
it had the big view. And Corbusier himself wrote about architecture as a pure creation of the spirit, and he was infected by this, the same point of view. Now, I'm saying that the modernists, short period from 1910 to 1923, about, were themselves involved in what I'm writing about. And then the old mechanistic paradigm came down on them, and the house and machine for living in and all of that, you know, economic.
As I remember, your principal basic, your principal criticism of modernism was in a sense that it was just form.
Yes.
Essential.
Yeah. Well, economic form, too.
Form and just, and therefore, I mean, there's a phrase you used to use, what maybe everybody does, and I'm not an architect, which was called double coding, was
right.
it?
Right, absolutely. You know,
which basically said architects have to do two things. One, be first responsive to people.
Right.
And then second, be responsive to architecture.
That's right, absolutely. Yeah. And I think postmodernism had to look both ways, because we were in a period in the late 70s when, you know, the profession had to produce things that were elitist, by definition, and does today. Basically, you know, I mean, to put up a technological masterpiece which employs 2,000 or 3,000 people to build it and may house 4,000 or 5,000 people, which is a large office building, let's say, the Seagram building, you know, small village, to design that, build it overnight in 2 years, requires an expertise and elitism and concentration that only a small group can give you.
Yeah.
But to say that that's enough in architecture is not right. So an architect has to look the other way, too. That's why I can double coding.
I wanted to show one other thing here before I go. This is a clip. This is called A Landscape of Waves. What you go into London, and I mean, this is Waves, Twist, and Soliton's conceptual drawings for gardens and furniture. Talk about this for a second.
Well, it's a garden that my wife Maggie and I are working on in Scotland, and a series of gardens, and we consult with physicists and other people. So the Soliton table in there is based on the idea of waves going through each other and twisting, whereas the overall garden itself is a series of twists and waves, water waves, and real waves, and landscape built waves that fold and migrate throughout. So it's a different kind of aesthetic.
This also is one of your Tell me about that.
Yeah. Heteropolis, the city of Los Angeles, which is, yeah. has, like New York, an incredible amount of minorities, incredible amount of tensions. It's a boiling pot, like not a melting pot, as Thomas Dewey once said of New York.
Thank you for coming.
Well, thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you.
Well, I enjoyed it.
My thanks to our guests for joining us this evening. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow night. Have a happy 4th.
Major funding for Charlie Rose was provided by the people at DuPont, originators of products and ideas that make a difference in everyday life. DuPont, better things for better living. And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the annual financial support of viewers like you. Charlie Rose was also made possible by these funders. To order Charlie Rose program transcripts for $5 each and video cassettes for $29.95 each, call 1-800-825-5746 or write to Journal Graphics at the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.